Lord, we would be committed here to your truth because in your revelation you have given us those things that we need to know for life and godliness. You have given us the foundations of freedom for persons, whether they are still in bondage or coming out of it, whether we are being freed or still trapped in the slavery to sin and to evil things. As we give ourselves to thinking about the foundations of multiplicity, I pray that you would give us clarity of thinking and a compassionate heart to recognize that this is an area where we can really minister your gospel in powerful ways. I pray your blessing for me and your clarity, and that we will communicate well during this next hour. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I got involved with this whole idea of multiplicity. The first person I know that I worked with who was multiple was Louder. Okay, we're working on cooperation here. How's it going? Okay, let me ask you a couple of questions first, and I'm going to go in descending order, so I want your hand one time of your involvement and your knowledge of multiplicities, and I will shape what I do here in light of your responses. How many of you are in regular active contact with somebody who is multiple right now? Hands. How many of you have read a fair bit about multiple, but don't really involve yourself personally with somebody who is multiple? How many of you have read little about multiplicity and are not sure what it is and really need some help? Hands. Okay, well, now that's kind of the level I'm going to aim this at. I met the first person I worked with who was multiple about 2.5 years ago. I've been involved in ritual abuse and such for about 7.5 years. Sherry and I have an adopted daughter who was raised in a Satanist home. She was a victim of ritual abuse. She's now 34 years old. She became a Christian when she was 24, directly out of Satanism. And we got involved with her about 7.5 years ago, and she became a resident of our home, and then over the years has become a daughter and has legally changed her name to Cindy Breshears. And working with her in terms of ritual abuse has given me quite a background in understanding some of the issues in ritual abuse. I've also worked with a number of other people who have been involved in various aspects of Satanism and occult and that sort of thing. 2.5 years ago, a support group leader who was a friend of a friend, I got the name and they asked me to call her, so I did. She had a person in her group who had just been diagnosed multiple, and they had just found out that she was being kidnapped by the cult, actually triggered, altars triggered, and she would go to the cult and do ceremonies. I talked to her psychologist not long after that, and the psychologist and I talked a bit on resources, and then she came back and asked if she could give my name to this woman. I agreed to that, and on October 14th, 2.5 years ago, this woman began the day not a Christian, ended the day a Christian. That was on a Monday in 1991. And then on Tuesday afternoon, she was triggered again, taken by the cult, ritualized severely, ended up in the hospital. Her father, who was a key perpetrator in the cult, was a policeman. And as she laid in the emergency room of the hospital, 3 security guards came in uniform, in a rather authoritarian manner. She ended up huddled up in a corner, just terrified because she thought they'd come back for her again. And then she ended up in the psych ward, locked up, which was a nice place for her to be, actually. And at that time, I saw her for the first time sitting cross-legged on a bed chained to the floor in the middle of a concrete-walled psychiatry ward. And that was the first time I sat down with somebody who addressed herself regularly as we. I didn't see any switching kind of stuff at that point. But in that process, as she was describing what happened to her when she was ritualized the day before, and I watched the bloody scars on her wrists and her legs where they had tied her up as they were ritualizing her. Of course, there were other things I didn't see. I found this 26-year-old, warm, bubbly, exciting, intelligent, fervent Christian, just the love of the Lord just bubbling out of her. And I had this vision of what was going to happen, because she was slated to be sacrificed on that Halloween by interior cult altars who wanted to go be sacrificed, keep the rules, and become dark angels for Satan. And they were set to do that. And of course, the cult was triggering her to do that exact thing. As I stood there in that room watching her, excited about the Lord and bubbling out the love of the Lord, I had this picture of her life bubbling out on a satanic altar. And I said, this will not happen. Not out loud, but I dedicated to that not going on. And we ended up spending 3.5 weeks with her, 24 hours a day, a team of us. She was married in October 16th of this year. She and her groom, a seminary graduate, stood in our chapel at Western. Instead of processing to, here comes the bride, big, fat, and wide, she processed to, he leadeth me, sung in a contemporary idiom. I prayed the prayer, and her pastor performed the ceremony, and as they finished, she and her husband prayed. They led the congregation in joyful, joyful, we adore thee. And she is a fervent Christian. Many of her altars have become Christian, including that whole group of altars that wanted to go be dark angels are now Christian altars. And it's just been a lot of fun to see things happening. I since then have worked with a number of other people that I know to be multiple, and some that I'd worked with out of ritual abuse before have turned out to be multiple. That's not uncommon, of course. What I've been asked to do here this morning is just do a basic introduction of what is multiple personality disorder, do it from a theological perspective and a ministerial perspective, and that's what I'm going to do for the next 50 minutes. I have put a good deal of stuff in your packet. And I'm just going to survey quickly some of that and point out a few things and believe and trust that you will read this in due time. You'll note in the header that it says short draft. There's another version of this that's twice as long, and I wasn't sure you'd read that, so I didn't put it in there. But if you'd like a copy of the longer draft, I will be finishing that up in the next couple of days. And if you want to get a hold of me while I'm here, I will send you a copy of the longer draft of that as well. So let's just take a peek here at some of the stuff. On page 41 of your booklet, there's a basic vocabulary. And I want to just hit some of these, because I'm going to be using these terms, and I think you need to know what they mean. Secondary personalities are alters. That's the way they're typically referred to. You get alters by splitting. The exchange of executive control is called switching. The personality whose outside responsibility is normal interaction with the world is usually called the host personality. The birth personality or central personality is usually called the core personality. And this particular personality has very important responsibilities in the system, because that's the one that's actually in control of the switching and also control of the splitting originally. And identifying who is the core and working with that personality appropriately is very important for therapists. The group of personalities is usually called a system. And when there's ritual abuse, and there is much of the time, ritual abuse or RA, when that ritual abuse is satanic, which it isn't always satanic, but when it is, then it's called satanic ritual abuse, or SRA. It's interesting that the anti-religious bias has allowed a lot of the secular psychologists to re-term this and call it sadistic ritual abuse. But it's still ritual, it's still in the context of a religion, and that religion is either pagan or Satanist. Those two are not the same, though they're related. The basic characteristics I've got listed for you here, the diagnostic criteria from DSM-3R, I have been trying to watch the literature and see what the definition and the diagnostic criteria will be in DSM-4, which is due out soon. And they're going to do a better job here. This is set up in terms of complete switching of two independent personalities. In fact, the way the systems work is far more complex than that, and you will find all kinds of influences. I think of it like here's somebody up in front, and here's another personality that comes up right beside and is talking in the ear of the person who's talking to you. And then that personality backs up, and another one comes alongside, and you'll detect changes, but not switching. So I've given you some analogies here to help you think of that in terms of a telephone conversation. This is suggested by some multiples that I work with. Very important perspective. Multiples are not psychotic. They are not psychotic. They think they're psychotic because they've been told by the cult, I'll just call it the group, whatever that means, they've been told by the group that they're crazy and that everybody will think they're crazy. They do things. They forget things. They act in odd ways. They come home. There's a red dress in the closet. They have no idea where it came from. Or they take their car and they park it in a parking lot and come back later and the car isn't there. And they have no idea where it is because while Jill has been out, parked the car, went to the store, Mary came up, took the car somewhere else, and then Jill comes back up and has no idea where the car is. Now that's not crazy, it's just that Jill wasn't there when the car was parked the second time. But they think they're crazy. So one of the best things you can do is help them deal with the issue of thinking that they're crazy, because they're not. Another important aspect is where MPD comes from. Page 42. MPD, or multiplicity, I actually prefer multiplicity to MPD. Multiple personality disorder, I think, really misrepresents, though technically it is a disorder. This is a gift of God's grace that they have this coping system for dealing with a traumatic abuse that otherwise would drive them crazy or leave them dead. So I prefer to use the term multiplicity rather than MPD for that reason. It comes from surviving devastating trauma, severe child abuse. And the way it comes, in just a basic idea, is here you've got a three-year-old girl, let's say, and every night or every regularly, dad comes in and rapes her severely. In all kinds of awful ways, dad does this. And this is overwhelmingly difficult. And what happens is Jill is dissociative. She is able to back away from this. It's not me that's doing it. Now, all of you dissociate. Some of you are dissociated right now. You're sitting in this room, but you're thinking about something in Waukegan, Illinois, and you're not even here. Or you're driving the car, and somebody says, "What'd you do while you're driving here?" You don't have any idea. You've been dissociated from the normal stimuli. We all dissociate to a certain level, but what these people are able to do is they're gifted, they're young, and they're able to dissociate to a greater degree, and what they do is they create a different personality, and that personality is named Mary, let's say. And it's not Jill who's being hurt. Jill isn't there. It's Mary who's being hurt. Jill is bright, she's creative, she's positive. When she comes into kindergarten and school, she's probably the top student in the class. The teacher loves her because she's so well-behaved, so helpful, and so positive. But Mary is vulgar, she's manipulative, she's evil, she undercuts people, she hangs around with all the wrong people, she never does anything nice. They're both in the same body. There's the night child, Mary, who gets hurt and does all these awful things. There's the day child, Jill, who survives very well in a different world. There's two different worlds and two different personalities, two different memory structures, and that's what we call different personalities. The day child, Jill, is very positive. The night child, Mary, handles the awful stuff. And that works very nicely until Jill gets to be 19, 20 years old. She's out of the home, probably into an abusive marriage. And as she breaks out of that system, the amnesic barriers between these two personalities begin to break down. And suddenly, Jill isn't there all the time of the day. The body is at work. Mary comes up and snaps at somebody. she gets fired. And Jill is walking down the street one day, and somebody really scutzy walks up and says, "Hey, Mary, babe, how you doing?" You know, and Jill is terribly embarrassed because her friends are saying, "What in the world?" And then it becomes, instead of a good coping device, becomes a real difficulty. But see, Jill is still not aware that Mary's there because the dissociative barriers and amnesic barriers are still there. And that's what happens. But as it begins to erode, then you begin to have problems. They discover the memory lapses. They're not good at covering it up. They come in to see the counselor, and they come in for depression or for borderline disorder or narcissism or suicidal ideations or whatever. And for a long time, people would go into therapy for many years and never be diagnosed MPD because the counselors were not trained to look for MPD. So they diagnose it with other kinds of things. And the current ideas are that at least 5% of the hospitalized psychiatric patients are undiagnosed multiples. And the literature is now saying that approximately 1% of our population, the same number as schizophrenics, are probably multiple, most of them undiagnosed. So it's a good deal more common than most are saying. Now, let me give you some structures for this. If I can have the first slide there. What is a personality? This is foundational to what's happening in your... It is in your handout. I'm not seeing it right at the second. 43. Thank you. Personality, it's right at the bottom of page 43, what's on the overhead here. Personality, a relatively enduring pattern of perceiving, relating to, and thinking about the environment and oneself that exhibited in a wide range of important social and personal contexts. So personality includes the memories, the behavior patterns, the social relationships, and there's a normal range of functions, emotional responses, and range of life experiences associated with it. Now that's normal personality. Most of us here have one personality. There are, in a crowd this size and in this particular group, I'm convinced there are some multiples here. Those people have more than one. How many persons are involved in a multiple? One person. What is a person? Well, that's on page 43. I've got it in large caps. A person is the central aspect of self-awareness, freedom, and you can think of it very simply in terms of a person being mind, the faculties of mind, will, and emotions. That's that part of us that have the faculties of mind, will, and emotions. Those are relatively neutral faculties. What controls my will is the values, the allegiances, the life experiences that build my expectations. And when we remember something, we group all of these things into our personality. So the person is the mind, will, and emotions. The personality is the grid, the worldview perhaps, through which the person expresses its own individuality, its own preferences, its own dislikes. What happens in a multiple is that you have two or more different personalities. When personality A is up, she likes bright colored clothes. When personality B is up, she likes pastel clothes. Personality A likes dresses and high heels. Personality B prefers slacks and loafers. Personality A, if you make a sarcastic remark to her, will give you one right back. Personality B, if you give her a sarcastic remark, will cry. And so it goes. Personality A, it thinks of herself as 23 years old, the age of the body. Personality B sees herself as 6 years old and reacts like a six-year-old. Now, what happens is that it's never that simple. If I can have this next slide. This is from Jim Friesen's book, Uncovering the Mystery of MPD, and he has two different personality graphs in there. This is the first one after this particular alter has been in therapy just a few months, and you see the way she has grafted her personalities, and she tried to show the relationships between them. Some of these are indicated by the kinds of, like negative voice is a descriptive title rather than a name. Others, Barb, Spock, guess what his characteristics are? Teacher, Socrates, Mother Teresa. These names are associated with the kinds of functions that personality has. After about 18 months of therapy, the next slide shows us how the personalities are graphed then. Now, if you compare these two, you'll find many of the personalities are still there, but you find a lot more of them, and you'll find some of what was originally one personality turn out to be a group of personalities. And that's not at all uncommon. And over on the left-hand side, you see the age range of the different personalities, approximately from 0 and 1 up through the main personality is, the core personality is 6 or 7, and then the front personalities are older and able to work themselves out. Now, that's still not a complex system. A complex system will have dozens of major personalities and hundreds of fragments. When they've come out of mind control and the programming that's not uncommon in the cultic and medical experimentation type things where there's programming, there's intentional splitting, the systems can be extremely complex. The story that I began with, the woman that came to Christ 2.5 years ago, is one of the more complicated multiples that anybody's ever run across. She's from intergenerational Satanist group. There's also medical experimentation associated on top of that, and she has a system that nobody yet knows how complicated it is. And the thing isn't so much how many personalities and that sort of stuff. After a while, you lose count. Even the multiple loses count. When you've got 350 identified personalities, it's tough to keep track of them all. And most of it handles with a few of them. But what happens, each personality has its own set of memories, its own set of experiences, its own job and system, at least the major ones, and that's part of the process is discovering some of these things and discovering why they're there. Now, one of the things that I want you to be very sure that you understand is the difference between person and personality. Because this is the foundation of what I'm thinking about here. This is what's on page 43 and 44. Remember, the person is one. Mind, will, and emotions, the basic human characteristics. Personality is the life experiences, the values, the things taught, the responses that are built up because of our life experience. The genetic traits, the genetic things, physical things, the character things that are there by birth are part of the person. The life experience type things are part of the personality, and those can be quite separate. So you can have personalities that are very, very different within the same body. Now, I want to address a few issues here. First of all, and these are aimed toward many of you that, man, is this stuff real? This is, I saw some of your reactions as I put this up, and you go, wow. I tell you what, when you sit with multiples and you learn these different personalities, and it's just a whole different thing. One of the multiples that I work with on a regular basis, I called on Thursday night to see how she was doing, and she's a very, very capable person and a good control of her system. And we talked for a little bit, and as we always do, we end up with praying. And one of the real fun things is I never know who's going to pray. And just the kind of the way we do things, I begin praying, and then she prays after me. And it's got to be kind of fun, because usually it's the upfront personalities, the major one is Phoenix. And she prays, she's just a very mature, wonderful Christian woman, about my age. But I never know who else may come up. And the other night, we'd finished praying, and the upfront personalities had prayed, normal, mature kind of stuff. And then she had said amen, and usually she says amen, good night. Between amen and good night, little girl popped in and said, in this pipey little four-year-old voice, because that's how old she is, and she started praying for me because she didn't like the way that the upfront personalities, they'd missed something important. And this pipey little four-year-old who prays amazingly neat prayers was up praying, and she only prayed about three sentences, and that was fine because that's the way she is. And it's just a real lot of fun. It really is. Put up the next slide here, if you will. This is a scripture meditation done by this particular multiple that I've just described that I talked to on Thursday night. By the way, I need to say, all the stories I'm using here are done with the explicit and genuine permission of the people involved. I am extremely careful about that. And I'll say more of that when I talk about the pastoral hints. This is a meditation on Psalm 19. And just a part of her own thinking and interaction with scripture. And what you see here, of course, is some very different handwritings. The first handwriting up there is about a seven-year-old boy personality. I don't know the handwriting. The next two handwritings, in the changing of the seasons, your steadfastness is seen, in the whisper of the wind, you leave behind the love for creation. I don't know who those are. The next one, you see just a whole different characteristic. It's done with a totally different hand. The spelling is weird. That's little girl. That's the one who prayed with me. So, but that's not enough for you, God. Who say thy people who are, and then she switched out and somebody else took over. That was all written in about 2 minutes. And as I didn't see this particular thing being written, but as I've seen other things being written where switching happens like that, her whole attitude changes when she switches like that. Her facial patterns, if you can imagine a four-year-old writing, what do? They're chewing on their tongue, they're not very good at writing. And then suddenly an adult, more adult personality will come up and they relax, lean back and write with a flowing hand, and you see the one with the strong says, see me, but they do not know. That's the host personality writing there. That's the one who's a competent professional that may be working right next to you in your place of work, and you don't even know it. Now, I have tried experiments. I've asked people, okay, you sit down and you write this particular thing and you change handwritings. And you know what? You can't do it. It just doesn't work. And what happens is, even if you do it, you can't maintain this with the flow over a period of time. I mean, you may be able to fake it once, but even there, it's real hard. Try it sometime. To get this kind of differences, you have to go left-handed. You have to write backwards or something like that, just to try to get the different things, because it's a behavior that you just don't pick up. But different personalities have different handwriting styles, and those of you who know a bit about handwriting know it's closely related to your personality trait, kind of what handwriting you use. And so as you can imagine, the ones that lean back are more reserved personalities, the ones that lean forward are more outgoing personalities, the ones that are more careful in the formation of the letters are more precise personalities, the ones that are all over the place are more free personalities, and that works with multiples as well. This is often a way that you can define a multiple is look at their journaling and you find this kind of thing, because that's a spot when different personalities may come up. And one of the ways that multiples discover themselves is they discover notes written in the house laying around from different personalities with different handwritings, different names, and they have no idea where the note has come from. But it's one personality writing to another personality trying to establish communication. It's interesting kind of stuff. Okay, why don't we turn that off? How do you deal with the reality of MPD? The woman who came to Christ 2.5 years ago, I have gotten to know her personality since that first time together. And over 2.5 years, those personalities are consistent. There are others that I haven't known as well or as long, but those personalities maintain. When people that are faking it, they can't do it. Even skilled actors and actresses have grave difficulty maintaining the persona that they're acting with. And one of the things, if you've been in any kind of acting classes, they really work with you is how to set yourself up so you can maintain a personality for the period of a play. How long is that? An hour, maybe 2 hours. And at the end of that time, the person, if they've really done it well, will be exhausted from the effort of maintaining that personality. These are people who do it in and out, day after day, week after week, year after year, and there's no effort involved in it because they're really different personalities. I've got some things in your handouts here on some of the reality, and there's more literature than that. One real issue, and this is the middle of page 45, many Christians reject the reality of MPD because it's not mentioned in the Bible. And I'm asked this pretty regularly as a professor of theology. People say, well, where is it in the Bible? And I can answer that very quickly and very definitively. It's not there. That's simple. Well, then it's not real if it's not in the Bible. So I ask them about computers or cancer or mental retardation or Down syndrome or schizophrenia or childhood sexual abuse. None of those are in the Bible either. Do we disbelieve those because they're not in the Bible? Obviously not. What we do is we work on a not a Bible only or a Bible and spirit only basis. We work on a biblical Bible and wisdom basis. The Bible informing us to the priorities of life so that we live under the commands of God wisely in the world. It's a major theme in Scripture. Study the ant. Why? Because it'll tell you something, it'll illustrate to you things that are true. I really believe that people deny multiplicity because they don't yet have sufficient empirical evidence to believe that it's real. It's so bizarre and it's so unusual that they've never had any experience with it, so they simply don't believe it. And I can understand that. But you know what I find? I find the same people who disbelieve in multiplicity also disbelieve in satanic ritual abuse. And for those people who disbelieve in satanic ritual abuse, I will invite them to come and listen to one of my daughter Cindy's relives that she does in the middle of the night when she is reliving the horror of being involved in a sacrifice and a cult ritual. I discovered that not long after she moved in with us. She had not slept in 15 days because of a particular event that had happened to her. And I was just real concerned for her. Her therapist wasn't able to do anything for her because she walked in the office dissociated, and that was that. She was just like a rock. So being the sort that I am, I said, well, I will just take over her life. And so I laid her down on our couch, and Sherry and I stood there, and she went to sleep. And 5 minutes later, she was in an incredible dream, writhing and screaming. And I thought, what in the world? I asked Sherry, do I let her go? What do we do here? I had no idea. So I woke her up, just because I was afraid she was going to hurt herself. I didn't discover until later nobody else could wake her up, because they would interpret that as somebody trying to hurt her, and she would fight them. I mean, for her life, she would fight. I didn't know that, so I just woke her up. Sometimes naivete is a help. Other times it's a tremendous disaster. You need to know a bunch. But about 3 days later, this is still going on, and I was just real frustrated with the process. I get like that, as you can tell. I was sitting there, and she was writhing around on our couch in our living room again, and I was so frustrated, because I'd wake her up, what are you dreaming, Cindy? She had no idea. And I was standing there, and she's writhing around on the couch and moaning and crying and one thing, and I said, Cindy, what are you dreaming? And she began to talk. And what I heard was the audio side of a satanic ritual which involved a child sacrifice. And I, as you can imagine, I stood there with my mouth hanging open, and for the next 45 minutes, I relived with her the majority of that ritual. She woke up. It's actually a relive, not a dream. She woke up, and then we went through it with her conscious. And for the first time, she was able to remember that particular ritual. She has other conscious memories she's had for a long time. And we've gone through that process many times. And I would just invite any of the false memory syndrome people who disbelieve in this kind of stuff actually, I'm not inviting them, but I rhetorically would invite them to come live with Cindy in one of those dreams. And then you explain it away as an implanted memory. Cindy has never been hypnotized, at least not by good people. she's never had memories implanted, that kind of stuff that they say. It's just not there. There is a reality there. It's bizarre. It's really bizarre. The people who are denying multiplicity many times are the same ones that are denying ritual abuse and the trauma of awful sexual abuse. And in one sense, I don't blame them. It's hard to believe that one person would really do that to another for pleasure. Of course, the Satanists don't do it for pleasure. They do it for worship. I've got some other stuff in here. Page 47, top of the page. Others deny multiplicity because of fraudulent claims to multiplicity. And they're there. They're there. There are fraudulent claims to multiplicity. There are fraudulent claims to satanic ritual abuse. There are inept and evil therapists. The inept ones worry me at least as much as the evil ones, who do implant memories by suggestion. And that does happen. I'm sorry that it does, but it really does. 5-6 years ago, if somebody came to you and gave you a memory of a satanic ritual, you could be almost sure it was real. These days you can't be, because there's so much literature there, and people will take a small thing and plant a big thing with it, and you have to be more skeptical about some of the memories. And that's real hard, because a person who really had that happen to them, the one thing they need very much is somebody to believe them. Because they've been told nobody will ever believe them, and they have trouble believing it themselves, at least some of the personalities do. So you got to be on this level between skepticism at one level and validation and encouragement on the other. And what I usually do is I find that the multiples themselves will do a lot of that for you if you provide a safe environment. And they'll sort through their own things. And the malingerers, what I find, this is what I actually do. I find that malingerers, and people are into this for confabulation reasons, they're in it because they want the attention of telling their story about ritual abuse or something like that. Well, if you're doing good work with them and you're putting them under expectation to work for their healing instead of just talking about what happened to them, they quickly leave because they don't want to work for healing. They want to talk about what awful things and get a lot of sympathy. And if you're not giving them sympathy in the bad sense, they'll go away. If you're giving them help in a good sense, the real ones will really work with you, and the fake ones will go down the street because you put too much responsibility on them. That's a pretty good differentiator, I think. But there's no doubt about it. MPD is a fad today. It really is. That's why there's so many of you here, I think, is because it's kind of it's a new kid on the block. You're saying, wow, what is this? Well, I want you to learn, but be cautious as well. How does one understand this whole thing theologically? I did a biblical study, and the summary of that is on page 48. Remembering now the difference between personality and person. Person is the basic genetic traits, the character traits that come from parents. The mind, the will, the emotions, relatively neutral. The personality are the integrated experiences of life, the values, the allegiances, those kinds of things. You have multiple personalities that may or may not be aware of each other, and you have a divided mind or a divided soul. And that's what I've got here in the first paragraph section on page 47. So, a disturbance of the soul, including the mind and emotions, where the soul becomes divided from itself. And what I did was take a look in Scripture. As far as I know, nobody else has discussed this. I got to get this in print before somebody steals it and puts their name on it. By the way, you have full permission to reproduce this material. I just appreciate you put my name on it. I found both Old Testament and New that there are examples of dividedness, not multiplicity, but dividedness. One of the interesting is 1 Chronicles 12:33, where the men of Zebulun are described as not having a double heart. That means you could trust them because you could predict what they're going to do. And what this does in Psalm 12:2, where the same idea comes up, is people with a divided heart, lev v'lev, which is literally a heart and a heart, are not trustworthy because you don't know which heart is at work. Now, they're not describing multiplicity there, but it's the same kind of thing. You don't know which heart is up in a multiple. So you never know whether you walk in, whether you're going to find a 6-year-old or a 46-year-old. And you find different reactions. Now, actually, a multiple can be very trustworthy as they get into therapy and they begin to work with their system. But an undiagnosed multiple won't be trustworthy because they're not in contact and you don't know which heart is up. I find the same kind of thing in James. Chapter 1 and chapter 4, 1:8 and 4:8, talks about people who are double-souled. Now, it's always translated in the things as double-minded. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. But the word there is psuchos. And as you, I hope, know, that in Bible, the word soul does not mean the immaterial part of the person, with very rare exceptions. Soul means the living being. Genesis 2:7, God took the dust of the earth, the breath of life, put them together, and the two together become living soul. Living soul is the whole being, looked at as a living being. And the double-souled person here is a division within the soul, and the soul would be the identity, the personal identity kind of things. And it's very similar to our personality. So the soul is divided against itself. And it's interesting to me that James 4:8 is right after it talks about resisting Satan and submitting to God. Now, again, that's not multiplicity and it's not ritual abuse, but it's similar enough to say maybe this is not a totally unbiblical phenomenon. This doesn't prove it, I need to say, but this illustrates that in Bible there's something akin to multiplicity. Now, I got to say I'm very, 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 very cautious about taking my neat theory and finding some biblical proof text to back it up. And this is too close to this for me to be comfortable. I won't use examples. I'm out of time. This examples of dividedness, though, I think can be very helpful as we look at it. One of the things that I find just, I was going to say this earlier and I didn't, I think I should here. Multiplicity does not result because a child got spanked when they were 3 years old. Multiplicity is a result of incredibly severe traumatic abuse. The multiple whose handwriting I had up here, she has a group of personalities that were formed when she was 3 years old. Just before her third birthday, she was at a satanic ritual, a group ritual, and her dad was having a change of heart. He had been involved in the group, apparently, but as he saw what they were doing to his little girl, he decided to rescue her. And he'd always loved his little girl. And we're not quite sure just what his relationship is, because three-year-olds don't remember things like that very well. But he came in on his birthday and tried to rescue the three-year-old from the group. And they killed him. Right in front of an almost three-year-old girl, she saw her daddy beaten to death. And then they took the body of her still warm daddy and her, and they stuffed them under a porch. And she spent the night under a porch of a house with her daddy. Nathan held her daddy's hand and said, "Daddy, wake up." Melody is in a swing, and she sings. Sorry, just to think about that. I know Nathan. He's a very responsible boy. He had to be. because he had to handle the contact. But it was overwhelming, so Melody, she just sings. And this particular woman is a soloist in her church. Guess who sings in her church? Melody. Because Melody was able to come out of the swing as we processed the memory. I don't do therapy with these people. Her therapist went through this stuff. But I've gotten to know this stuff from getting to know Nathan and Melody. And there are a couple other personalities. That's not a spanking. This is traumatic, awful stuff. So compassion and gentleness goes a long, long ways. What's the relationship between alternate personalities, demons, and programs? This is one of the very, very difficult things. Just let me just say one more thing while I'm talking about that. When you're dealing with something like this, recognize that when you come on as an authoritative person, especially in a spiritual warfare context, and you take authority and you command something, you just blew it big time. Because these personalities have been commanded all the way along. And you will really have trouble at that point. You must be very gentle and very encouraging, not commanding or authoritative. You just got to be real, real careful about this, especially as you get into the demonic stuff. Alternate personalities and demons. Demon possession, of course, is a form of multiple personality, but it's multiple persons. It's not multiple personality disorder. And I've adapted Jim Friesen's chart here out of his Uncovering the Mystery of MPD. And I found this to be very helpful. But I must warn you, and I'm sure if Jim were here, he would as well, be very, very, very careful about a mechanical application of that chart. One of the things I have discovered in my own ministry and working with spiritual aspects with multiple personality disorder is that many of the alters will present as demons. And they will be really evil, really vile. They will curse God. They will curse you. They will curse everything. They will do everything that a demon will do. They will claim all manner of things, and they'll do it very believably because that's the role they took on in the cult. And they may be demonized personalities, but they're not demons. I had a woman come to see me just a month or so ago. Her therapist is a good therapist and works under supervision, and her supervisor suggested that she come see me, and I did. So the therapist, the pastor, and the client, and I met together in my office. Because in session, they'd had a demon present. Now, this therapist is trained in spiritual warfare. She's not in deliverance methods, and she's got some good background. And this thing presented and just scared the liver out of her. And she didn't know what to do. So she called Gerry. And so we came up, and that was my thing, was to do some spiritual exploration. And I did that, and we got to know each other, opened up. And it turned out that the two demonic personalities that they had identified, neither of them were demons. They were both. One of them was about an eight-year-old boy alter who that was his job to protect system, and the rituals was to be a demonic personality. He wasn't a demon at all. He was an angry, vile boy. And when we were in a context of forgiveness and acceptance, I saw that angry, demonic, and it scared me too, he was good, become an eight-year-old boy weeping with the idea that he could be forgiven and accepted. Don't be too quick. In fact, what I do is I expect that if something will come up and talk to me, it's probably an alter. And what I do at this point is I am persistent in talking about the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. And I find often, not always, often, that it turns out to be alters. And they will receive forgiveness. But you must be persistent in dealing with grace and forgiveness. And those of you who are involved toward deliverance sides will, I'm afraid, too quickly take authority, command the demon, and kick it out. Now guess what the rest of the system is going to do when you command authority and kick out an eight-year-old boy, or try to? You're never, ever going to see any of them again. Because they won't trust you, for a very good reason. You've proved yourself untrustworthy. you have proven yourself to be an abuser. And I use that term advisedly. What does conversion mean when there are different personalities? Or the way I put it when I talked to my class on this, if this person were to die tonight and you have Christian personalities and you have cult active personalities, will they go to heaven? It's a wonderful theological question. It's a John 9:3 type question, you know. What, who sinned, this man or his parents? You know, what do you do? Kick his mother too hard in the womb? It's a typical theological question. What will happen? Well, conversion is a process. Conversion is always a process, unless you think of the point of justification. Conversion is a process. I have been a committed Christian for, 25 years or so. And as I examine my own thinking, actually a little longer than that, I really committed myself as a 19-year-old. So that means 35 years old. No, 25. That's right, 25. My math isn't very good either. What happens as I look at my own thinking? I suspect that about 60% of my thought patterns are really Christian. The other 40%, I'm pretty secular. Now, if that's true for me, as somebody who works really hard on bringing every thought into captivity to Jesus Christ and takes very seriously Romans 12:2, be renewed by the transformation of your worldview, which I think is what mind means there, and I'm still only about 60% there, is it surprising that somebody who is multiple will have some personalities will be strong, fervent, loving Christians, and other personalities that will be hostile to Christianity? Then you bring in the factor on top of that, that they were programmed to hate the name of Jesus. And this programming is very sophisticated, mind control, medical type stuff many times, and they do stimulus response, and I've got an article in here on basic programs for you to read. It's areas you need to know a little about. Is it any surprise that you have problems in that area with unconverted personalities? So a lot of the work that I do in multiplicity is dealing with altars that are not Christian. And I just do evangelism. It's the same thing I would do with a person who is a survivor of sexual abuse. I talk in terms of forgiveness and acceptance and God's cleansing. 4 more minutes, huh, Dan? Let me give you one thing I do. 1 John 1:9. If you confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you from what? All unrighteousness. You know that. What is confess? Homologeo, agree with God. One of the altars I was talking to, a different one that I've mentioned so far, I was going through this thing, and I said, what does confess mean? She said, well, it means talk about. I said, that's great. That's exactly what confess means for a Christian. It means talk about. It doesn't mean beat yourself up. It means talk about to a loving God who is unconditionally for us as Abba. He wants to have the sinner come to him. Remember the prodigal son? He's not waiting to beat you up to take some penance out on you. He loves to have sinners come to him. So what do? You talk about. If we confess, talk about our sin, a bit of technical stuff. A genitive, which is what that is in Greek, can be either objective or subjective, so with an active noun, a verbal type noun. Sin is a verbal type noun. Your sin, our sin actually, can either be the subject or object of the verb. Okay, now think with me. I know this is a little different. Our sin, where our is the subject of the verbal idea sin. Our sin is what? Something I do. If we confess the sin I do, he is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us. But let's make this an objective genitive. Not our subject, sin I do, but our sin object, sin done to me. What do we have now? If we talk about the sin that was done to me, the defilement and the dirtiness that comes from the cultic abuse, God is faithful and just to cleanse us from all of that. It's a powerful truth. Powerful truth. It's not just the sins I've done. It's the sins done to me as well. It's within the legitimate interpretive range of that passage, though I grant that it's not a common interpretation. In the last 2 minutes, back on page 35, I have a number of suggestions. This is aimed particularly for pastors. And I've tried to summarize a lot of stuff. I've gotten a lot of input from different people, different therapists, different multiples on this. I need to do a couple of things on this. One is I've got to change a mistake. There's a drastic mistake on page 36. Terrible mistake. Awful mistake. Page 36, and it's aimed at you. 4D. So you've already found it. It says you are not Messiah. That's true. On the other hand, mistakes do not invalidate your ministry. Please put that in there. That would be, maybe Satan was in my computer at that point. You will make mistakes. Golly, Ned, you'll make a jillion mistakes. Be humble and admit it. They don't invalidate your ministry. What invalidates your ministry is arrogance and pride and the refusal to admit your own mistakes. There's a lot of stuff in here. I want to conclude with this, two things. One of the things I've found in dealing with multiples is that major issue is page 38, number 25. There's a lot of good suggestions here. I'd love to unpack them with you. But 25 is probably the most common mistake I see made. You must move this person toward responsibility and competency. This is page 38, number 25. Move them toward responsibility and competency. Avoid dependency. These people have been victimized by the group. When you do anything for them that they can do for themselves, that's not mercy, that's sin. And I'm saying that as strongly as I can because it really is. When you do something for a victim of abuse that they could do themselves, that's not mercy, that's sin, because you are re-victimizing them. Your job as a helper, as a caregiver, is to help them grow. You're there to equip them for life, not take responsibility for their stuff. They have learned, as a matter of survival, to manipulate you into taking care of their stuff. They've been taught that. It's not their fault when you fall into that trap. It's yours. You must learn that. You must hold boundaries. You got to be wise in that. But at the same time, you got to be a caretaker and a mercy giver. I just got last night this book. It's available right through the door there. It's one by Cheryl Knight and Joe Gretzinger. It's in your referral thing. It's called Caregiving, the Cornerstone of Healing. This is a great workbook. It's what I've got here in more detail. And I'd really encourage you to get a hold of a copy of that. It will be real helpful to you. The last thing I'd like to do, I'd like to read you a poem, actually two poems. This is written by the one who did all the different handwriting there. She is a gifted poet. Multiples are always creative. They have to be to do the things that they do. And this gifted poet wrote these two poems. I'd just like to read them to you because I can't say it better than she does. How can we tell you what it feels like to have a dagger in the mind? What words could make you hear the fear that we do sometimes find? Which eye could you see not to blink for the horror? When would your hands reach out to hold us when we're filled with sorrow? We wish sometimes, just like you, that our daymares weren't true, that we didn't see strange men die, didn't hear frightened children cry. Didn't remember bloody knives raised high in sacrifice. Didn't dread the zenith of the full moon night. We wish fresh wood smells didn't place us in a box, or a certain color green sends us to the barred room always locked. We wish a baby's cry didn't remind us of our own lost ones, or a man walking toward us makes us want to turn and run. There are times when we watch a family life and think that maybe that was us in a time before the memories came, the time before me knew us. But our